Greetings all. I am Monty Alexander, piano person. First thing I want to do is thank Sister Gail Boyd for creating this platform so that some of us, music people and other, can say a word or two or three that are mainly about encouragement. Because we music people, part of what we are doing, or I like to say supposed to do, is encourage others. And as I wind down this first section, I want to play a little song that means a great deal to me. And I'm going to now ask my dear colleague, Katerina, to hit the button and move the dial. Here is Mr. Sam Cooke.
I was born.
There's a change coming. It's this thing where things get so egregious and challenged all the way. And pain and suffering is upon us. This is, as through all of history, this is the time where I use this analogy, which is not the nicest thing to hear. When you have a boil and eventually the boil break, it don't feel nice, but guess what? New skin and a fresh start. So we're looking forward to what we call a fresh start, whether it is the weather that is terrible, yes, whether it is the economy, yes, whether it is the virus, yes, whether it is this horrific situation in America that I well remember is so much like what I experienced back in 1968. As a musician, I was playing at these various clubs. All clubs that were clientele were people of all nations, ethnics. I mean, back in 68, I played in Watts in LA, and this is in Detroit. This was in New York at Mittens Playhouse, and that was when they took the life of our beloved Dr. Martin Luther King. So that was 1968. I haven't counted, but that's quite a few many years ago. And here we are now, the boil breaking again. But this time, it could be the signal to a brand new start for us to be human beings with each other. And we're called by the great Creator to love one another. Well, that ain't easy when another could be so hurtful to us, right? On each side. People with mistaken ideas about what makes people feel superior to the other person. Nobody is superior. Equality. These notes on the piano, equal to each other. The A note, white note, the black note, the A flat note, equal. One don't work without the other. So this music has been my gift all through my life. It was my passport to making friends, traveling the world. This piano, passport. And it gave me 60 years of having a profession. As I said, I got my notebook here. It's a big notebook because lots of things to say within the short little time I've been invited to speak by Miss Gail and company. So, I've been told that I'm somewhat of an inspirer. But I say inspirator, Jamaican style. I'm not going to say inspirer. That's hard to say. I am an inspirator, meaning it is my responsibility. I feel this way. Yes, it's nice for people to like me, hopefully, because I play a nice song. But there's something about inspiring. The Bible says exhortation, which is a responsibility if we have that gift. And I think I've been given that gift. And I know I've been given that gift. So I'm here to inspire because I'm an inspirator. Yes, folks. So coming from a wonderful place in the world for me with challenges called Jamaica. I'm not talking the Doris truck out in Queens. Jamaica is a wonderful place. The island in the sun gave us mangoes, coconuts, Bob Marley, Harry Belafonte, his family, of course, he's born in Harlem. But Jamaica was a great breeding ground for a little kid who fell in love with music at the earliest. My first musical instrument is a rubber band. See, Jack? I played the tune on the rubber band. Start playing the rubber band. Musical rubber band, right? Then I had the buckle top, right? Rhythm on the buckle cap. So to me, the first music I play is a rubber band on a buckle cap and the desk in school. For me, the desk was mainly for beating drum than writing notes because I was a very irresponsible child at school. Mathematics, give me a headache. Music paper, give me a headache. Consequently, the little music piano lessons I had, I rebelled against because I didn't want the lady to hit me on the knuckles and say, Alexander, she was an English lady, play that note that way. Pop, hit, rah. Folks, I was already playing. I was already playing that, so I didn't want to play whatever that song meant. So, I was a rebel from a kid, and I was told years later that this rhythm and blues music, which I love dearly, and the rock and roll that came from it, that was a kind of stealing from the real rhythm and blues, and the thing called jazz, these were music of the mental, the people that were in rebellion against a certain establishment and a society that says, you have to do it like this. Jazz people say, no man, I'm going to do it my way. Jamaican said, man, me I go play the thing my way. Okay. So I became in love with music and piano playing. And after we heard this piece of music by the great Sam Cooke, that is a wonderful inspiration. My dear, could you play a little piece of that music?
Could you play a little piece of that music for me, kindly? Yes.
No. Hold on. Not that one day. Hold on. But I tell you what. Hold on.
The sim we were playing?
Yeah. Well, I was talking about great Sam Cooke. No, I saw... Yeah. I saw Sam in Jamaica. And I was fascinated with Sam Cooke. I also saw Brooke Benton. I saw Jackie Wilson. I saw Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers. Why do fools fall in love? Right? And Sam Cooke, who came with his ensemble, including a drummer that was playing with him, the man's name was Leo Maris. I got to know Leo real good. He had adopted the religion of Islam and he became Idris Muhammad. A wonderful man and a wonderful rhythm guy from New Orleans, yes. So Sam Cooke and this song, which is a great inspiration for Monty Alexander, because when I feel down and low, there's all sorts of things to do to get myself up. And one of them is music. Down, sweetheart. In fact, I got my words here. When Sam sing that song, I was born by the river in a little tent, and just like the river, I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know. I'm saying, I know a change is going to come. And I'm afraid to die because I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. So we have a prayerful man named Sam Cooke. In fact, he was a great gospel singer in the church in Chicago, where his family had belonged. So, music, right? So now I'm Mr. Piano Player. I shall now play a song that meant a lot to me, which I had the joy, honor, privilege of recording and performing with the composer himself. A man, he wasn't a medical doctor, but he became a doctor through schooling or music or something. His name was Billy Taylor. We used to call him Dr. Billy Taylor. And I remember he came into the Blue Note when I was playing there, and I saw Dr. Billy Taylor, and I said, we're honoring the great Dr. Billy Taylor. He's in the audience. And he got up, and I said, doctor, and I lost my mind because I said, doctor, give me a prescription. We had a laugh or two. And now I'm going to try to play the song that meant a lot to many of us. It's called I Wish I Knew How It Would Feel to Be Free, a song that the great Nina Simone recorded and gave much upliftment and hope to a group of people that had been thrown by the wayside, that had been taken against their will and put in the bottomless pit of a boat all the way from Africa, Liberia area, what I'm hearing there. So, thank you. key. Somebody who needs to inspire himself and hopefully transfers to you folks is to inspire and to fortify your own version of being inspired and having hope for tomorrow, because tomorrow, today right now is a challenge. The boil warm bus, Jamaica say, but when it busts a little more, then come a new version of hope, and hope and leading towards that thing called peace, P-E-A-C-A, and then respect, because even before love, I love you. We have to respect, because respect is also action, and the action is protesting in the peaceful way. And I encourage and I hope that the peaceful protesting don't stop till some nice change like Sam Cooke sing about just now. So, enough of that for a second. Now, I would like to invite you to hear a song that was talking about a man that was born in Jamaica. That was the beginning of a movement where people of color, black folks, started to feel better about speaking up. His name was Marcus Garvey. And Marcus Garvey is a song by a brother from Jamaica named Winston Rodney, known as Burning Spear. He wrote this song. Marcus Garvey, run the tape. Thank you, my dear.
Yeah, the tape stuck.
Oh, Lord.
Good. Hold on. Here
we go. Hold on.
Marcus, young birds come to town. Marcus, young birds come to town. Can't get no food to eat. Can't get no money to spend.
Came to the conclusion that there was very little respect for black people, and he put himself in harm's way by speaking up against the establishment. Consequently, he went to jail. He came to America, and Marcus Garvey started a movement back in the 30s, and he went to England, and he was in Harlem. There's a park that used to be called Mount Morris Park in Harlem. In fact, I had the pleasure of playing up there a couple of summers ago with my Harlem Kingston band. And the park don't name Mount Morris no more. It's called Marcus Garvey Park. So Marcus Garvey is a presence in American culture. Now, you know, they name a park after him, right? So Marcus Garvey sang about the ills and the challenges of people who are in desperate situations. And he spoke about it, and he spawned a movement, and Jamaica had a lot to do with it. Now, as I said, Jamaica, where I come from, 1944, June the 6th, tomorrow is my birthday. Yeah, man, I'm getting another year, right? And tomorrow when I speak, I have my own, what you call it, virtual talk, and I'm going to be talking about a lot of things. As far as Jamaica is concerned, I grew up, I heard Mento Calypso music, I heard rhythm and blues, and I saw my number one hero, Louis Armstrong.
Louis Armstrong.
Yes, I did. And I saw that concert, and that was the beginning of a new hope for Monty Alexander, because I had no desire to go to school anymore. I never went to music school. and I never studied. And I must tell you that I was the worst student in the world, but I found out about the joy of humanity and being around people. And I saw Satchmo, and my father knew the promoter, and I went backstage and I shook Satchmo's hand, and I don't think I washed it for a while. Yes, maybe about 2 weeks. And then the next day I got a trumpet because I wanted to be Louis Armstrong. And I started standing in the mirror saying, hey, good evening, everybody. And I would do my impression, and I loved it. And not long after that, I saw Nat King Cole. Not King Cole, but Nat. Nat King Cole. And I heard those songs that my mother and father would dance to in the living room. So those were my original inspirations. And then I came to Miami, Florida in 1962. And somehow I was blessed to get a job playing the piano in a bar and a culture that was really filled with some challenging people, because 3 o'clock in the morning I'm playing the piano and the hooligans and the gangsters are there and the alcoholic boat people are there and the drug dealers are there, and the grace of the Lord saved me from that life. So I was spared from that. Now checking my notes, I have spoken about Monty Alexander, where he came from, how we did that. And that was 1962, I came to Miami, and that's where I met Frank Sinatra. Mr. Sinatra saw me with his friends, and he called me to the table. I said, nice to meet you, sir. And he said, young man, you're swinging. We're gonna get you into New York. And that's how I came to New York. Frank Sinatra and his friends hired me to play at a place called Gillies. Then, while I was getting into the game, just before that, I ended up in Las Vegas, and I saw what Prejudice was like, because there was a guy, a musician I knew, who was thinking about ripping off a music store. His name Gator, won't tell his last name. And Gator had gone with me to the music store. He needed to fix his bass amplifier. And the next thing I know is, I said, Gator, if you go there to take things from the music store, we definitely go into jail, because you black and I look like a Mexican. So that was the first encounter I personally had with what could happen, and that was in Las Vegas, 1963. So then, okay, I'm cutting off from that. I remember though, in 1968, after Dr. King was murdered, was the time I was driving to the airport, leaving Detroit, where I had a gig at the Drome Lounge, I'll never forget, and the tanks were coming up the highway. Tanks, yes, because the riot was in full force, you know? So here we are, 2020 is a repetition. In fact, even more significant because of that terrible thing that happened in Minneapolis, the murder of George Floyd. Bow my head in respect. So I'm conscious of all this. Music is a salve. And now as I speak to you today, I'm going to talk about projects. My first and most outrageous project, I made an album of Thelonious Monk's music. But I was inspired by the realization that Monk was raised up amongst a group of West Indians, people from the English-speaking islands of the Caribbean, Trinidad, Jamaica, Antigua, Barbados, Bermuda, various places. And that was what he was inspired by. And so I took the songs of Monk and recorded them with a real rhythm from Jamaica. And guess what? The people liked it or loved it, and I got all these compliments and sold it wonderfully, just independent record, right? And just now, and tomorrow, my birthday, June 6th, is the release of Warrica Hill. Check this out. Vinyl record. People say, when you go make a vinyl record? And here it is. So it'll be released tomorrow and will be available if you're interested. Okay. Where's that girl?
On your website.
Oh, yes, it's on the website.
Dubai.
Believe it or not, Monty Alexander got a website. Yes, yes, folks. So that's one project. And tomorrow, June the 6th, my birthday, is going to be the 10th installment of what I call Reminiscing in Rhythm, or in Jamaica, I'm going to say Reminiscing in Rhythm. Let me say it again. Reminiscing in Rhythm, or Reminiscing in Rhythm. On my Facebook page and YouTube page. These are new phenomena for a guy who came from the analog era. So, those are the three projects. And last but not least, a wonderful moment. I was invited by good folks at the TCM cable channel that shows the classic films that made me want to come to America when I saw these movies in the theater and I heard that music. A lot of it was what we call jazz. Jazz. A lot of them, Louis Armstrong, had, my hero, had performed in High Society, the story of Red Nichols. The Satchmo was a presence in Hollywood, mainly because of his association with Bing Crosby. He was the biggest star, Bing Crosby. Okay, so TCM on June the 8th and June the 15th, Monty Alexander running his big mouth. Yes, that's me, and I'll be talking about music in the films and mostly what we call jazz, J-A-Z-Z. British style, ZZ, okay.
We come to the Q&A portion.
Oh yeah?
We have already a question or a comment from Miss Gail Boyd.
Miss Gail Boyd, you mean my sister, my one and only loving sister, oh my word. What about So Much Trouble in the World? Lick down So Much Trouble. Please be able to hit the So Much Trouble.
Okay, before we get to that, okay, now we get to the question.
Yeah, we'll get to the question. We'll play So Much Trouble and we'll play Redemption Song. We gotta get Redemption Song in.
Wrong one.
No.
Wrong.
You lost the job.
Yeah.
I hired you. Bob Marley, Robert Lester Marley, Keith, Marcus Garvey, Muhammad Ali, Malcolm X, Dr. Martin Luther King, and a host of, I call them today's prophets, messengers of love and peace. Bob said, there's so much trouble in the world. Holy, really a lot of trouble, you know, but no joking now. We're going to fix it because we are the human race, and that's the best race of all. Human. We have the solution is called purposeful action, and I gotta get off my, you know what, and get out there and open. The doctor said, oh, leave the house because you're 76 young and you're not supposed to leave the house, and I'm concerned that everybody rubbing up in the street, and we'll have to do them tests, you know. So shall I play a little song?
I don't know, this should be Q&A now, but
well,
if people have questions, ask away.
Cut that down, Dave. Cut that down. So, all together.
Ask away. Do you want to answer Gail Boyd's question?
Oh, yes, Miss Gail.
Miss Gail, she said, I just said that this feels very much like 1968. What kinds of music came out of the struggle in 1968?
Well, the struggle... At that time, I just played that song by Dr. Billy Taylor. You heard Nina Simone singing it, and there was the rise of the music that I was also connected to from Jamaica, when these masters of the political statements out of Jamaica. Then, of course, I was in Detroit, and guess what? One day, they sent a car for me and the friends of mine, Bob Cranshaw and Walter Perkins, to take us to a place called Hitsville. What's Hitsville? Hitsville was the invention, the creativity of Mr. Barry Gordy. They brought me and Bob and Walter to go there and play on a track for one of those singing groups. And I tell you folks, I can't remember which it was. But that was the first experience I had with, not Motown, because it was Motown. It was Motown. And the music of Motown, Smokey Robinson, The Miracles, Diana Ross, and of course Marvin Gaye. Some of the music that was very moving. It was 1968, 69, 60, 70, I'm not so sure exactly when. But that was me driving to the airport and tanks are coming up the highway. That was what was happening in 1960. Meanwhile, I'm playing piano here, there, everywhere, just having the time of my life like a fool, you know?
Another question.
What?
Somebody's asking, did you ever work Sandy Erica? Did you ever work with the drummer Jack Costanzo?
Oh, I did not work with Mr. Costanzo, but I certainly knew Mr. Costanzo. Met him once, and he was the terrific hand drummer, conga drumming, bonga drumming percussionist with Nat King Cole, my other great hero, because Nat in the early days had the trio before he started having the big hit songs, just him singing with the strings. But he still had a second version of the combo where he invited a conga drummer, and that was Mr. Jack Costanzo. I think Jack was from Chicago, and it wasn't so long ago that he passed. He was almost 100 years old, and I treasure the fact that I actually saw him on the stage in Jamaica when Nat came to Jamaica, and I went to the concert. I snuck out of school, and I saw Jack Costanzo, and he was awesome. Yes.
Question? Nope, you can keep chatting away.
So Bob Marley wrote a song called Redemption Song, and it is about, it starts, it says, old pirates, yes, they rob I, they rob me. Sold I, sold me to the merchant ships. Miss, after they took me from the bottomless pit. But my hand was made strong by the hand of the Almighty. We look forward in this generation triumphantly. So we're looking for triumph over the challenge, right? And Bob Marley said,
somebody's asking, and it's all the time we have, but what advice would you give to artists and musicians in the fight for liberation?
Search your heart, search your soul, play musical notes that tell the story of how you feel. The schooling is all well and good, but dig deep. And I tell you something that I do when I play and people say, how come you play like that? Well, here's the fact. I pray that I can find a few good notes, because I don't even know the names of some of those chords you heard me playing. I just kind of pray that I play a good chord, literally. So little by little, pick out the melodies. If you want to play the national anthem, figure that out in whatever key. Find the key. And at that note, I'm going to say, y'all take care, respect, one love, and positive all the way. And don't stop fighting. One love.